咁我哋夠鐘啦，亦都夠法定人數。
Members, it's the appointed time. Welcome to the policy briefing of the policy address. One briefing by the Secretary for Justice and the Director of Administration on the Chief Executive's 2021 policy address. I first invite the administration in. We have quite a number of officials today.Including Ms. Teresa Chang, SC Secretary for Justice, Ms. Maggie Yang, Director of Public Prosecutions, Ms. Christina Chang, Law Officer Civil Law, Ms. Linda Lam, Law Officer International Law, Mr. Michael Lam, Law Draftsman, Ms. Gracie Fu, Director of Administration and Development.Mr. Daniel Chang, Director of Administration, Ms. Eva Yam, Deputy Director of Administration, Mr. James Ding, Commissioner of Inclusive Dispute Avoidance and Resolution Office, Ms. Wendy Chang, Deputy Judiciary Administration Operations, Ms. Esther Leung, Judiciary Administrator, and Ms. Patricia So.Deputy Judiciary Administrator Development. Welcome. Today, we also have representatives from the Hong Kong Bar Association, including Mr. Paul Harris, SC, and Ms. Anita Yip, SC. Good morning.Members who intend to speak, please press the button when our officials are ready. We invite the Secretary for Justice to walk us through the paper. And then the Director of Administration. Thank you. Chairman, members,As an international legal deal-making and dispute resolution service hub in Asia-Pacific, Hong Kong has a sound rule of law system and boasts deep common law traditions. It is the only common law jurisdiction in China and has a wealth of experience, talent in legal and dispute resolution services. And Hong Kong is in a good position to...take advantage of the numerous opportunities presented by the National 14th Five-Year Plan, Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau, Greater Bay Area Developments, and its Shanghai Plan. The new policy initiatives and other key new initiatives of the DOJ in the 2021 policy address have been included in the paper submitted earlier to the panel. Today, I will walk you through four new key areas of work of the DOJ, including thecomplementing of national development to develop Hong Kong into an international legal and dispute resolution services center in Asia Pacific to promote the correct understanding and knowledge of the rule of law and to continue to promote Vision 2030 for rule of law, to promote a sense of belonging, to enhance education on the Constitution, basic law, and national security, and to build on our strengths and attract legal talents.On the first point, Hong Kong's international rankings in rule of law and judicial independence are always at the forefront, and the relevant indicators have remained outstanding, and we are continuing to improve. Our advantage in rule of law allows mainland and international investors to conduct business transactions and resolve business disputes in Hong Kong in a comfortable manner.And recently, the DOJ achieved a number of breakthroughs on arrangements on judicial assistance in civil and commercial matters with the mainland. In order to implement the arrangement on reciprocal recognition and enforcement of judgments in civil and commercial matters signed in 2019, the DOJ is proactively preparing a bill and will consult the public in due course. The arrangement establishes a more comprehensive and clearer mechanism for reciprocal recognition and enforcement of civil and commercial judgments between both places. In May, the Hong Kong SAR government and Supreme People's Court signed the record of meeting on mutual recognition of and assistance for bankruptcy insolvency proceedings to establish a new cooperation mechanism for cross-boundary corporate insolvency and debt restructuring matters between both places. Meanwhile, the supplemental arrangement on arbitration signed in November last year and the arrangement on reciprocal recognition and enforcement of civil judgments in matrimonial and family cases signed in June 2017 were applied locally through legislation in May. To allow the local legal profession to further develop the mainland market and to meet the needs for legal and dispute resolution services in the Bay Area, the DOJ launched a number of initiatives, including the first GBA legal professional examination, in which the results were announced earlier. The DOJ signed a record of meeting with the Supreme People's Court to provide practical mainland legal training courses for Hong Kong's legal professionals who pass the exam. The Qianhai Plan provides for a higher level of opening up in legal matters, including the ways to improve the mechanism for wholly owned Hong Kong enterprises to adopt Hong Kong law and choose for arbitration to be seated in Hong Kong, establish a new mechanism for civil and commercial judicial assistance and exchanges, deepen the reform of the partnership association mechanism, etc. Earlier, I met the trade and took in their views on how we can better grasp the opportunities presented by this Qianhai Plan. In terms of international exchange and collaboration, the DOJ will continue to encourage international legal and dispute resolution service institutions to set up camp at the Hong Kong Legal Hub. And we are now actively exploring with other institutions, including the Asian African Legal Consultative Organization, to set up an arbitration center in Hong Kong. The SAR government has been fighting for more opportunities for legal professionals in the public and private sectors in Hong Kong to take part in work related to international law. With the strong support of the Office of the Commissioner of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Hong Kong SAR, five young talents from the Hong Kong SAR were seconded to three renowned international legal organizations. The DOJ will continue to explore with other renowned international organizations on more secondment programs to enhance manpower training and capacity building. The DOJ is also securing the hosting of decision-making meetings by international organizations, and we have secured the ALCO annual session and UNCITRO Working Group 3 intersessional meeting to be held in Hong Kong at the end of this year. The DOJ will take advantage of the characteristic of one country, two systems, three jurisdictions in the Greater Bay Area, and to look at the interfacing of legal rules with relevant departments in order to establish mutual recognition standards and mechanisms on issues of interest, including intellectual property and e-commerce, and to secure business interests. The Guangdong Hong Kong Macau GBA Legal Department's Joint Conference passed a working proposal last year to set up a GBA mediation platform. The accreditation standards and the code of conduct best practices for mediators in the GBA could be passed at the third joint conference at the end of this year. The Sale of Goods United Nations Convention Bill was passed at LegCo in September, and since time is needed for preparation, the bill will commence 6 to 9 months later.
To promote the correct understanding of the rule of law, continue to implement the Vision 2030 focus on the rule of law. The rule of law is the core value of Hong Kong and the cornerstone of its success. in order to promote the correct understanding and the practice of the rule of law in Hong Kong society, the Department of Justice launched the Vision 2030 for the Rule of Law 10-year initiative last year and has established a task force comprised of well-known local and international experts to make recommendations to the government. In order to effectively evaluate the rule of law and facilitate research and capacity building, the DOJ is actively conducting research on the rule of law and collating relevant data in preparation for the establishment of an objective rule of law database in Hong Kong. The Department of Justice will launch the database during the Hong Kong Law Week from November 1st and to 5th this year. Other key projects of this year's Hong Kong Law Week include the Unicitral Asia-Pacific Judicial Summit and seminars related to rule of law and discussion on law tech issues. In terms of local rule of law education, we have launched the 3E's rule of law projects for the general public, young people, and the professionals, namely engagement, empowerment, and enrichment. Following the launch of the Studio DOJ and the primary school touring drama, we organized the International Youth Exchange 2021 in September. Recently, we have compiled a booklet called Rule of Law Empowerment and launched activities such as the Rule of Law Journey, a law quiz competition for primary schools, a short film competition for secondary students, and continue to install law-abiding awareness in primary and secondary school students to explain the profound concepts in simple language. 3. Strengthening cohesion, improving the constitution, basic law, and national security education. The quality of the rule of law education is crucial to promoting the correct understanding and the rule of law implementation in Hong Kong society. Under the Empowerment Rule of Law Project, the DOJ has launched the Rule of Law Enlightening Program and Teacher Training Program for primary and secondary school students and teachers and assisted teachers in preparing materials on the rule of law and the basic law. In order to strengthen the promotion and allow the public to correctly understand the Constitution and the Basic Law, following the Basic Law 30th Anniversary Legal Summit with the theme Back to Basics, in November last year, the DOJ plans to hold in April next year another seminar on the Basic Law and will publish the source book, Basic Law, Selected Drafting Materials and Significant Cases. In terms of national security law education, following the National Security Law Legal Forum, Security Brings Prosperity, held in July this year, the Department of Justice plans to hold another legal forum on the Hong Kong national security law to enhance the understanding of the HKNSL for all walks of life. 4. Consolidate strength, recruit legal talent. A huge network of local and international legal talents is a key advantage of Hong Kong as an international legal and dispute resolution service hub. In order to attract and retain top legal talents, the DOJ will adjust the talent list to include legal and dispute resolution professionals, relax the qualification requirements in mediating international transaction lawyers, and regularizing the pilot scheme on facilitation for persons participating in arbitral proceedings in Hong Kong, which will facilitate more qualified Hong Kong non-Hong Kong residents coming to Hong Kong to participate in arbitration proceedings on a short-term basis. Conclusion. With regard to the key new initiatives and policy measures described in the document that I just introduced, I seek the support of this panel. My colleagues and I are happy to answer the question from members. Thank you, Chairman and members. Thank you, Secretary. Now, invite Mr. Cheng Chung Wei from the Director Administration. I will just succinctly outline the measures from the Department of Justice and the policy address from the policy address supplement, that we've been trying to deploy technology to enhance the efficiency of the courts and, where appropriate, to conduct more remote hearing. And based on existing statutes, the remote hearing cannot apply to criminal proceedings. The judiciary plans to amend the law by empowering the judges and the judicial officers that where they see as appropriate to conduct remote hearing. The judiciary has conducted the first round of stakeholders' consultation on the key policy proposals, and the government will dovetail work with judiciary to work on the detailed legislative amendments before introducing the bill to LegCo. And for the legislation to implement procedure reforms on the family justice system, the judiciary plans to introduce new legislation to reform the procedure rules for family justice system to ensure that they will be more cost-effective and facilitate its users. The administration government should also work closely with the judiciary and will submit the amendment bill for LegCo vetting as soon as possible. On court facilities, the government departments is offering their full support for improvement projects, and they have been completed substantively, including at the expanding the defendant stand at the Wan Chai courts, and also a major expansion of one of the courthouses in Wan Chai. I know that some members have paid a visit there. And the Chuan Court building has now been recommissioned in order to speed up the handling of the defendants involved with the opposition to the proposed legislative amendments. And on the Wan Chai Court Tower, there will be four new court rooms that so that in the interim period before the completion of the new district court, that this facility can be used to handle more cases. And on the legal aid, on this September 30th, the LegCo had passed the legal amendment that the financial eligibility limits have been raised by 2.7%, and this took effect on 8th of October. We will likely review it next year based on the changes to CPIC. And for the review of the operation of the legal aid system in terms of administration, distribution cases, and selection of lawyers, the review is almost completed. We'll consult the Legal Aid Service Council and will report to the council on the outcome of the review. And that's the end of my short introduction. And myself and the Judiciary Administrator and the Director of Legal Aid are happy to furnish information and take members' questions. And while from the Hong Kong Bar Association, can we invite the representative from the Bar Association to express your view? Let's say keep it under 10 minutes. Mr. Paul Harris, Senior Counsel.
There's a great deal that the Bar Association welcomes in this legislative program, and I'd like to refer to a number of particular things. One of them is the proposal to allow video evidence in criminal cases. This is something for which provision does exist in other jurisdictions and has done in some places for quite a long time. We consider that in principle it's right to be making this sort of provision, so we welcome this. Secondly, the provision of additional courtrooms is of course very welcome. Justice delayed is justice denied, and so providing more courts so that the waiting time is shorter is of course very welcome and desirable. We also welcome the proposed bill on family law, which is implementing a number of recommendations which have been in the pipeline for some time. So we're pleased to see this. I have with me my first vice chairman, Mrs. Anita Yip, SC, and I'd like to invite her to speak specifically about the family law issues.
Thank you,
Chairman. We welcome the proposal on the legislation in relation to streamlining the practice and procedures of family cases. It was mentioned in the policy address that the key recommendations of the Working Party on Family Procedure Rules will be adopted to produce a single set of self-contained procedural rules for family cases. Under the recommendation, a new Family Procedure Rules Committee overseeing the making of new rules and amendments will also be established. It is well known that the existing rules governing the practice and procedures of family cases are contained in a number of different ordinances, and for years it's proved to be difficult even for judges and practitioners to locate the relevant procedural provisions governing individual cases, not to mention the daunting task facing those who opt to litigate in person, which is a pretty popular approach in the family court. It is hoped that the proposals will greatly promote efficiency in the family law practice and reduce the cost and time expended thereon. Equally welcome is the proposal to appoint a children's commissioner. We would, however, encourage the compliance with the general comments of the UN Committee on the Rights of Children and International Standards by making this a statutory and independent commission. The Hong Kong Law Reform Commission and the broader legal community have also called out for reform of our child protection laws. It is pleasing to learn that the government will take up the proposals of the Law Reform Commission on reporting of child abuse. In this regard, we urge that there should be public consultation on the matters raised in the Protection of Children Legislation Amendments Bill 2019 that was discussed favourably in the LegCo in 2019. Although there are good changes, a number of matters relating to family law practice remains unsatisfactory. All the more so in relation to insufficient family judges and the heavy workload. It is well known that the family court has an unlimited jurisdiction, such that the family court adjudicates cases involving millions and millions of dollars, but insufficient resources have been expended on the family court. Based on existing statistics, there were 21,157 divorce decrees per annum in 2019, plus, of course, an unknown but sizable number of other family cases not involving a divorce, for example, cases relating exclusively to children, relocation, variation applications, etc. The wide scope of jurisprudence, the unlimited jurisdiction, and the heavy workload is being handled by 7 permanent family judges and 4 deputy judges only. By way of comparison, Singapore, comprising 5 million people as compared to our 7.5 million, has 7,600 new divorce cases a year as compared to our almost 22,000 cases. It currently has 44 judges in its family courts of justice, excluding the high court judges hearing family cases. So Hong Kong has at least 3 times the caseload of Singapore, but the equivalent of only 1/4 of their judges. And also, insofar as insufficient family court rooms, it is not possible simply to appoint more deputy judges as there are insufficient courtrooms chambers in the current district court to house more judges. A recent ad hoc request to specialist practitioners has indicated that about 30 specialists are prepared to sit as deputies as and when required, but is more space available? Compared to Singapore, they have currently 10 courtrooms and 12 chambers, totaling 22 hearing venues. We have 3 times their caseload and only 10 family courtrooms. That is less than their half of their venues. There's also a lack of tech support for the family court. During COVID, Hong Kong was outcompeted by other common law jurisdictions such as England, Australia, and Singapore, which held remote hearings from a very early stage in 2020. Whereas remote hearings have become more frequently used in other courts since about the second quarter of last year, the family court is still limited by lack of VCF facilities and tech support. 1 or 2 VCF equipment on trolleys are wheeled around from court to court. There is no or very weak Wi-Fi in the chambers for the family judges. Thus, it is not feasible to have simultaneous use of judges' chambers for remote hearings while having hearings, while live hearings are being carried out in courtroom by another judge. The judges' chambers are not fitted out to record proceedings, so it is not possible to use those chambers to hear cases anyway. Now, the above are just some of the inadequacy or insufficient resources being allocated to the family law jurisprudence. We hope that there will be more welcoming changes introduced in the foreseeable future.
好，唔該曬。咁啊，呢個時候咧就到我哋委員提問時間啦。咁啊，如果未
open the floor to questions. And from ma'am, I pass the button please to you now. And now we have Mr. Martin Liao, 5 minutes. As we all know that the Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau carry the characteristics of one country, two system, and three jurisdictions. Of course, we expect there's some interfacing problems. However, to achieve win-win cooperation, we must explore the interfacing of GBA laws in setting up mutual recognition of criteria and mechanism. In this September, the government announced the plan for comprehensive deepening reform and opening up of Shanghai, Shenzhen, Hong Kong modern service industry cooperation zone with more specific instructions. According to the paper, the DOJ on the e-commerce and another field to do some exploration. By choosing certain domains to conduct research on the GB law interfacing, what are the factors for consideration? And for the legal authorities in the GBA, have they discussed or divide the task of conducting the research?
I think so.
When the DOJ explores the interfacing issues in IP and other areas, are there concrete timetables? Secretary, thank you very much for the question. The DOJ recommends us to take advantage of the unique characteristic of one country, two systems, three jurisdictions, and proceed to relevant interfacing work. At the CPPCC, a special session was set up to explore this area of work, and I have provided my comments to that meeting. But this requires more than the work of only the DOJ. Collaboration between the three places is needed. So at the meeting, we can discuss all these issues. You asked about the standards for identifying the areas of legal work. The legal departments of Hong Kong, Macau, and Guangdong province held a joint conference. We had our first meeting in 2019, and we would discuss various legal issues and identify interfacing arrangements, and we are working on a new mediation platform. So legal interfacing is a very important issue. Through the meeting under the CPPCC, there will be coordination from the central government. So in terms of civil and commercial matters, priority would be given. And the timetable is not dictated by the DOJ alone. Through a communication mechanism, we will work on the priority areas first. In terms of e-commerce and intellectual property, the DOJ believes these are areas of interest in the Greater Bay Area. That is why we propose the study of these areas. Through meetings, we will discuss with the authorities in Macau and Guangdong Province, and we will also look at it at the special working group under the CPVCC. Chairman, in terms of dispute resolution services in the Greater Bay Area, this includes arbitration services. The interfacing of or the recognition of qualifications is very important in arbitration and mediation. I think we can follow some internationally recognized procedures. At Shanghai, there are plans to improve the mechanism for wholly owned Hong Kong enterprises to adopt Hong Kong law and choose for arbitration to be seated in Hong Kong, but this might not necessarily be able to apply in the Greater Bay Area. So are there any adaptation or facilitation measures? Would you explore a model law in the area of IP? There are similar plans. So based on international legal norms and principles, can model law be developed in the Bay Area? Thank you very much. For Hong Kong enterprises on the mainland, many of them told us that they want to adopt Hong Kong law. So at the former Tianhai area, there were 11,000 Hong Kong enterprises, and we tested the application. According to China law, if there are no foreign-related elements, even Hong Kong enterprises cannot adopt any law except China law. So with the help of relevant authorities, in 2019, a proposal was adopted in Shanghai. And the scope of Shanghai was expanded to 120 square kilometers. So the expansion of the scope to adopt Hong Kong law for Hong Kong enterprises is certainly very helpful for these enterprises. But from an operational perspective, we propose application in Shenzhen first before expanding it to the Greater Bay Area. This would allow Hong Kong enterprises in GBA to eventually be able to adopt Hong Kong law. Currently, under China law, if no foreign-related elements are involved, currently the pilot area is relatively small, and we hope to expand that. With Shanghai, Shenzhen, and Guangdong Province, and even the central government, we have expressed our wishes and like the Shanghai plan. We will later determine the actual implementation arrangements. Mr. Liao asked whether we can adopt model law, what the best practice might be. And this is something we would think about under the legal interfacing arrangements, and communication between the three jurisdictions would be needed. Thank you very much. Mr. Tony Chair. Chairman, I'm not a member of the panel. I am a professional myself. The Tianhai area was recently expanded, and that presents a lot of opportunities. And how do we deal with the interfacing of legal issues, and how we can exercise Hong Kong's strengths in order to take advantage of these opportunities? These are very important. The policy address discussed how Hong Kong can grasp opportunities under the National Development Plan. In terms of talent, according to the policy address, the DOJ would have a strategy or policy to retain talents in law. And in terms of nurturing talents, the common impression was that not enough talents were groomed. And some people have the impression that it's not easy to become a practicing lawyer. And according to paragraph 153 of the policy address, there will be relaxations, but I believe it only applies to talent in commercial dispute resolution. But what about other types of talents? I believe our talents must have basic understanding of mainland law in order to better exercise our strengths. Hopefully the Secretary can tell us more about that. A number of amendment laws and new laws were passed this year. Do we have enough talent in law drafting? We will study a number of laws, and there could be amendments to the laws as well. So hopefully the Secretary can tell us more about the manpower arrangement. In terms of the grooming of local talent, for those returning to Hong Kong who are fit to become practicing lawyers at the PCLL, Scarlet is a statutory body. They have been reviewing the relevant work. And in terms of attracting talent under the policy address, in 2018 and 19, and we have focused on deal making and dispute resolution. We have emphasized the element of deal making, and this was reflected in our talent list as well. Even though the focus might still be on dispute resolution professionals, for experienced transactional lawyers, we hope to attract more talent to Hong Kong. Hong Kong has a robust financial market for different institutions to grow. As for nurturing of local talents, the DOJ consistently hosts international conferences to allow participation by the legal profession in Hong Kong so that they can learn about the latest legal services on the mainland and overseas. So we are consistently presenting these opportunities for the profession. In terms of international organizations, we have secondment programs, and they mainly apply to government lawyers. We are working with two organizations to allow practicing lawyers in the private sector to be seconded there. And hopefully our profession can gain greater understanding of the operation of international legal organizations, and hopefully this experience can benefit Hong Kong. The law drafting division indeed has a heavy workload, and according to the policy address, the CE intends to introduce a number of bills into LegCo, and some bills are being drafted or are about to be drafted. So we hope to reinforce manpower at the law drafting division, and they would conduct their work in the most professional manner. And meanwhile, the law drafting division is also organizing a number of seminars or workshops to outline the work of the division to the legal profession. So apart from providing legal advice, well, they would know that lawyers can also engage in law drafting, and through these workshops, they can learn about basic drafting principles or techniques. So this is what we want to achieve through those workshops. The first will be held on November the 24th. And we are applying for CBD points from the Law Society. Thank you very much.
Next, Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to take this opportunity to ask you about the Qianhai, about the opportunities for our profession. Looking at the numbers, currently Qianhai, we have 11,500 Hong Kong-owned companies. And this time, the Qianhai will be expanded for 8 times. You can see there's enormous potential. Well, at the numbers mentioned, well, for the Hong Kong-owned legal firms, well, the paper mentioned there are currently 9 law firms office in Qianhai. I suppose it's rather on the low side at this stage. Well, we have over 11,000 Hong Kong-owned companies there, and yet there are only 9 Hong Kong law firms office. This is probably quite disproportionate. I see there's room for more, and especially that Qianhai is now expanded by 8 times. So the question for the Secretary, looking into the future, what mechanism will be in place to facilitate our legal practitioners to open up office in Qianhai? Even though the paper mentioned there's no restrictions on the ownership, well, would education and promotion need to be strengthened? I know that the solicitors may not be too familiar with how it works. I wonder if you can do some explaining. Now that we have the GBA legal exam, the GBA Legal Professional Exam. After the result announcement on September, the Secretary said that they would discuss with the mainland counterparts to organize more training before allowing the lawyers to practice in the GBA. Well, compared to the opening office in Shanghai, would there be any synergy or any room to collaborate? I want to open up more opportunities for our legal practitioners. Okay, I would like to ask the question first. I will save more for later. Okay, thank you, Mr. Chow's question. Yes, indeed. For the GBA legal professional exam, well, by way of this exam, we can attract more Hong Kong lawyers to practice in the mainland. Well, I just want to compliment to Holy Owned Hong Kong Enterprises, who hope to work with Hong Kong lawyers well versed in the mainland law. As for the Hong Kong law firms, well, it's mainly about the partnership association mechanism. Even though we have reduced the ownership restrictions or thresholds, I agree with Ms. Chow's observation that somehow the results are not as good as we anticipate. I'm talking to the professional to see what went wrong. From what we heard, the investment capital required or the insurance arrangements are the core issues. Well, once we know the areas of concern, then we can discuss with the mailing counterparts on how do we address them. If you notice that in the Shanghai plan, they specifically stated that partnership association mechanism is one topic that this plan will explore. We are aware of the problems. Then also we are aware of the issues concerning insurance and so on. The GBA legal professional exam and the those lawyers who are qualified to practice then they could be hired by the mainland law firms, and there will be a huge synergy by allowing the Hong Kong law firms to form partnership with the mainland law firms to open up more opportunities. I see that this synergy is way more than 1 plus 1 equals 2. So we will proactively promote this professional exam and the partnership association mechanism, and to make sure that they will actually gain maximum opportunities for the legal profession. I'm not a member of this panel, but I just wanted to chip in. As heard from the Secretary's address, for the Hong Kong students, the DOJ is stepping up legal promotion and education projects. Since 2019, well, I see there is a weak sense of law abidingness in many in the community. Well, for the primary, secondary, and the tertiary institutions, by offering more education is only be a good thing. I see there are opportunities in the GBA by enabling the lawyers to develop their career there. Well, in Hong Kong, there are quite a number of lawyers, and while there are not many court cases, by offering more opportunities could only be a positive news for them. Well, 2 weeks ago, I'm aware there's a GBA legal professional exam, and a few of our colleagues have actually passed the exam. What is the overall pass rate? Well, the GBA is part of China with a different legal system. If our lawyers go up there, we belong to a different legal system, what are their opportunities? According to the Direct Administration on Legal Aid, a lot of members of the public have their own views with extensive media reporting, and some of the law firms, if the legal aid person can appoint their own legal firms, were there a suspicion of the transfer of interests? Whereas some law firms may get more cases briefed out from the legal or appointed by the legal aid department. We need to help the defendants if they can't afford the judicial proceedings. Must they appoint a designated law firms or lawyers? For all the lawyers included in registered, they should all get an equal opportunity to be appointed. I put this question to the Director of Legal Aid. I'll answer the first two questions first. On the pass rate of the exam, we do not have a specific number. Put it this way. The pass rate of National Judicial Exam is posted on the website. It's known to be a difficult exam. Even though that this is a GBA legal professional exam, the scope is smaller since deal with civil and commercial matters. I suppose that the pass rate may be higher than national legal exam, as I heard that most of the legal practitioners I know managed to pass, which I could see as pretty good news. In terms of the future directions, this is how I see it. For the legal professions, they need to look beyond Hong Kong. I would say less and less people only has one practicing qualification. Most people have multiple qualifications like UK and New York and Hong Kong, or China and New York and Hong Kong and so on. Therefore, an additional qualification is a key trend on international legal development. Therefore, we might get it right. And why is this opportunity is crucial to our development and also for our business sector? After they pass the exam and they are qualified to practice, they can actually be hired by mainland law firms or even become a partner in the mainland law firms. It seems that if they're qualified to practice law in both places, then they can provide they can actually serve both Hong Kong and mainland companies in both places. Under provision of legal services, commercial and civil matters is quite broad. The Chen Haibo is quite clear. Besides just providing legal advice, they're also qualified to appear in court in the 9 cities in the GBA. That means they can serve as a court advocate on behalf of their clients involving in Chinese laws and disputes. If they can appear in court, then they can also serve as an arbitrators and not related work. Therefore, I do see huge potential. Therefore, I encourage everyone in the legal profession to seize this opportunity to sign for this exam. We just had the first exam last month, and there will be more in the future. While some may claim that I don't know what's like to practice in the mainland, so what does the court and the judicial proceedings look like? As I state in my address, we've entered into a meeting minutes with the Supreme People Court. Well, it's just a matter of time that we'll provide training for lawyers who pass the GBA legal professional exam to know about the proceedings in mainland courts. I hope that we can help the qualified lawyers to familiarize themselves with the mainland legal proceedings. And now the Director of Administration, Mr. Daniel Cheng. In my opening speech on the review of the legal aid system is almost completed. As for the concerns raised by Mr. Xu, we will address them. I hope that you can give us a bit more time so that the review can be completed. Next, Ms. Elizabeth Kwan. I strongly support the Secretary of Justice for Hong Kong to seize the opportunities. Therefore, in helping the profession to tap into the mainland opportunities, I support all these facilitation measures and also support a legal rule of law education and national security law education. Well, I'm asking about the case backlog and the review of the legal aid system. I welcome the administration that in district policy address that providing additional courtroom to expedite the disposal of court cases. I know that a lot of the cases related to the Black Lives riots are clogging up the courts. I'm worried that will there be enough judges to preside over these cases? Is judge shortage one of the major headaches faced by the judiciary? Another question for the Secretary, as of the end of July, I know that there are over 10,000 suspected arrests for the opposition to the anti-extradition saga. There are now over only 2,600 has been charged. What's the progress of the prosecution? The public felt that it is too slow. What contributed to this slowness? Anyway, could expedite the prosecution, even with more courtrooms that you may not find this useful.
For the judicial reviews filed on non-refoulement claimants, there are currently more than 8,000 cases. How would the judiciary deal with all these cases of judicial review? How long would it take to clear the judicial review filed on non-refoulement claims? Very often, the applicants will continue to lodge an appeal if they lose the judicial review, and this would impose a great burden on the judiciary. In terms of additional courtrooms, would more courts be convened? In paragraph 18 of the paper, you indicating that you are actively reviewing the existing legal aid system and the review is almost completed. The review does not cover the appeal mechanism on legal aid, and we ask whether there should be specified lawyers and for the woman who claimed to have a ruptured eye. The case was not substantiated, but she secured legal aid. And so the public wondered why the judiciary should decide the legal aid assignments. So could this be included in the review as well? Secretary, followed by the director. I will first address your second question. First of all, I'd like to thank members for their support. We will continue to work hard on rule of law education and to promote our legal services and take advantage of the opportunities. In terms of prosecution work, the police would make arrests based on reasonable suspicion, and our prosecution standard is a reasonable prospect of conviction. When we lay prosecution, we will look at the evidence and point of law. And timing-wise, we would consider a number of elements, including the nature of the case, its complexity, etc. In the cases of PolyU, in December 2019, 213 people were arrested by the police, and 21 trials would take place at the district court. And the earliest trial will take place from March 2022, and the latest trial will start from October 2023. Another example I can share is the riots at the central government offices and Queensway, which took place on September 2019. Some of the cases will begin trial from September 2023, and for the case in Central in November 2019, 28 persons were arrested by the police. We have laid prosecution, and the trials will take place in 2023. So most cases are pending trial already. I talked about some of the our major principles, so I cannot comment on the cases one by one. Judiciary Administrator, thank you very much. For the judiciary, as suggested in the paper, for cases arising from opposition to the proposed legislative amendments and non-refoulement claims, there has been an upsurge, and that presents great challenges on the court facilities and manpower, and we have introduced a number of initiatives. We have exhausted all court facilities and courtrooms, and we have expanded some law courts buildings and introduced new facilities. For cases involving a large number of defendants with enough courtrooms or facilities, these cases could be dealt with as soon as possible. For non-refoulement claims, as Ms. Quad said, we have a backlog of a few thousand cases. Meanwhile, we do have a number of measures. At the Court of Appeal, the procedures would be streamlined. Before the amendment, a Court of Appeal would be formed by three judges. Now it could be formed by two judges. We also recruited extra deputy judges and non-permanent judges to try these cases. At the Court of First Instance of the High Court, with the extra manpower, we hope to deal with up to 2,000 cases per year. At the Court of Appeal, with ample manpower, we hope to deal with 1,000 cases per year. So in the next 2 or 3 years, we hope to clear the backlog of cases. As for the issue of manpower, the courts are constantly recruiting based on vacancies. Since the end of last year, at the three levels of court, they have been recruiting, and permanent staff has been reinforced. And in terms of deputy judges, the judiciary has a few dozen deputy judges, and hopefully through the different approaches, we can deal with the backlog of cases. For cases of JR for non-refoulement claimants, the figure stands at more than 8,000, and the judiciary said they would try to process 2,000 cases a year. So to deal with the backlog of cases, you need 4 or 5 years. Chairman, we are spending $1.2 or $1.3 billion per year to deal with appeals for non-refoulement claims or the JRs for non-refoulement claims. And so long as these people remain in Hong Kong, they present risks. So if you have to spend 4 or 5 years to deal with the backlog of non-refoulement claims, this is unacceptable. Are there any other ways to get around this problem? If the applicants fail in their JR applications, they would appeal further. So the judiciary must come up with a way to deal with it. We will keep tabs on the caseload, and if possible, we would make manpower deployments, but we have to strike a balance because judges of the High Court must deal with other cases apart from non-refoulement claims. If we can secure more facilities and deputy judges, then we can deal with more cases. Director, would you answer the question on review of legal aid? Our review is almost completed, and we will brief members on the results and take in members' views. So perhaps we can have a discussion at a later stage. Would the review include the appeal mechanism for legal aid? Related matters on the review or the appeal mechanism for legal aid would be looked at. But we would not actually look at or address the appeal mechanism. When would the report be available? I cannot say for sure when the report would be available. After the review is completed, we will take in members' views. We will consult the Legal Aid Services Council and report to the panel. Dr. Niso. Secretary. Ms. Chang would like to add something. For the backlog of cases for non-refoulement claims, the DOJ is proactively dealing with them. Some laws passed in the recent years would help deal with the backlog of cases. The Director of Administration talked about new laws. For instance, some cases can be dealt with a court of two judges instead of three. And in terms of the immigration ordinance, it was amended such that the processing time is now swifter. There are a large number of outstanding cases. But for certain cases, for instance, lengthy proceedings, certain limitations were imposed by the court. for instance, if repeated applications were made without new evidence, restraint orders have been imposed by the courts, and relevant applications were also made by the DOJ for cases of deliberate delaying of proceedings. These measures would help speed up the processing of cases. Dr. Junior Seo, thank you. The questions asked by Ms. Kwok were indeed complicated, and more time is needed to discuss them. So at the end of the day, we must look at the results and indicators. For non-refoulement claims and the cases involving black-clad violence, the figures are far below par. So you talked about completing these cases within 1 or 2 or 3 years, and I don't even think they could be cleared within 3 years. The spirit of rule of law is very important in our society. The biggest bottleneck lies with the DOJ. So how can we come up with key performance indicators? Did you look into the complexity of these 7,000 cases? Did you set a deadline for completion? Of course, the police and DOJ must do something. And the judges should also do something. They should not just casually allow adjournments. If the council asks for 6 days, well, how would the judge or listing clerk make a decision? They should play the role of gatekeeper. For instance, if a counsel is not available, other counsels could be used, and so. But still, the judges tend to be too lenient on the counsel, so that is why a lot of time is needed on judges' leading. Adjournments are very common. And sometimes we have to wait 1,000 days for a judgment. So there were many reasons to the problem. I'm not against the idea. I'm not against the initiatives mentioned in the policy address to, for example, to develop Hong Kong as an international legal and dispute resolution center.
Well, the ADR can resolve a lot of problems for the judiciary. However, in the prosecution units, I see a lot of problems. Even by creating ADR positions, it won't help. I'm not seeing any solution. We're talking about more than 1,000 people, and they are like more than $100,000 in salary with a few supernumerary positions for 5 years. I come from the legal profession. I know there are problems inside, and yet there are bureaucracy inside. Maybe some of them are willing to help, but others are not cooperative. And things lie cold. Why bother with the urgency? At the end of the day, there's still a long wait. We need to change this culture. May I ask the Secretary, what key performance indicators do we have? We have like over 7,000 cases. Can we address them in 1.5 years, and I heard in a visit to the West Canada Lord building, well, the CJ said they only to dispose 600 cases out of 2,000. And well, they, when there were 7,000 cases yet to be tried. The judiciary claimed that they were working very hard. They never replied the way they would open night courts. Well, and now they were expanding the court. Well, why not just conduct televised trials instead? KBI is one thing. Training is another favorite topic of mine. I appreciate the DOJ's work with the USITRAL secondment program. Well, this is a drop in the bucket. Just 5 persons for 6 months. Why don't we work closer with the Law Society? For example, like send 20 to U.S. and for quite a lot to the Middle East, to the U.K. and so on. There are a lot of law firms in Hong Kong. As the DOJ can take the lead by offering subsidies and allowances and allot the places through the Law Society, we have hundreds of new lawyers every year. How do we broaden their global horizons? That will help ourselves at the International Legal Hub as a regional IP hub and so on. Well, you took $1 billion to take care of the non-reforming cases. Why don't we spend $300 million to subsidize the young lawyers to learn in different parts of the world? Let's say 3 months. Where do we get this idea? Let me finish. Maybe the secretary knows already. In the mainland, well, in the past, they sent over 100 lawyers to intern at our law firms. And now we need to have a global vision. We should walk the talk by sending our long lawyers abroad. Well, we should send by the hundreds. In 500 years, we need to train 500 lawyers. I'm more than happy to approve this funding for this, for nurturing our young talent, instead of burdened on the non-reforming cases benefiting the dozen or so law firms, which impeded our social progress. Secretary, please. Thank you, Dr. Ho's comments. And first thing, I want to correct that him. Maybe I misheard him. He mentioned on the progress of criminal cases, he linked it to the promotion of alternative dispute resolution like arbitration and mediation. Alternative dispute resolution constitutionally cannot deal with the criminal cases. This only applies to the civil and commercial cases, and please don't confuse the two. And we hope the public understand. Well, you can't take a criminal cases to arbitrator. They can't deal with these. But let's put this aside. I shall respond to one by one. I agreed on the last point on the training. On the secondment, well, we're only to send 5 to the international institutions. Well, the original quota was 1 per jurisdiction, but now that I'm able to get 1 place for public lawyers and 1 for private lawyers, well, the rules are set by the international institutions, and we can't control them. Well, I agree that when you send Hong Kong lawyers to overseas to work or to learn, however, this is not what the government can direct, as it requires the law firms and the chambers agree, or even the lawyers themselves agree to work and practice overseas. Well, for the bigger global law firms, after working in Hong Kong, they may spend some time in New York and Beijing. That's how they provide their training, which we strongly support. As for what can the government do, Well, the government, well, due to COVID, were not able to proceed. There was a program that supposedly subsidized Hong Kong lawyers and solicitors and barristers to international legal seminars, which covered the airfare, the accommodation, and the registration fees. The purpose is to let these young legal practitioners, after attending these seminars and obtaining the knowledge, they can able to broaden their global perspective. At the same time, we request them that upon the return to Hong Kong, they will need to conduct a sharing with other young lawyers. That is what the government can do. However, due to COVID, we can't send anyone to attend these legal seminars, and we can implement it after the end of the pandemic. In terms of prosecutions, while I will not respond to the remarks on the courts, on the prosecutions, as to when do we decide to prosecute? Well, let me cite the examples. For the Poly U case, the police arrested over 200 defendants. The preliminary opinion of the DOJ that the court or Raymond is the November 19th and 20th. Well, for the rights, the Queensway and the Central Government Office, and the police arrested 881. And on October 2nd, 2019, these 96 persons already appeared in court and prosecuted. And for the central rights, took place in November 12, 2019. 28 people were arrested. In 2019, 13, 14, and they appeared in court and prosecuted. Well, these are past events, therefore we can disclose it. From time to time, we work with law enforcement agencies. If there is insufficient evidence and what other materials should be provided, well, such kind of correspondences that we will issue guidelines from time to time so that the police can submit to write evidence and exhibit for us to decide whether reasonable chance of conviction in order to initiate prosecutions. Currently, for these cases, on the prosecution side, we will not ask for successive deferrals. Well, however, the defendants may request for a postponement on their part. Well, for the eventual court dates and for the court hearings, for each case, there are many factors in play. It's hard to draw a general conclusion. Therefore, I disagree that the bottleneck rests with the DOJ. Thank you. I would like to extend this meeting as a few members asked for a second round. As there will be another meeting at 10:45, therefore, I need to make some allowances to vacate the room. Well, I'll be quite strict with the members. Let's say 3 minutes per round. Next, Mr. Martin Liu, Deputy Chairman. I see there are two policy measures related to professional development. First, establishing Hong Kong as an APAC International Law and Dispute Resolution Service Center. And two, and providing legal service in the GBA and as well as dispute resolution services. Well, these two will be the key source of opportunities for the legal profession. The question, how should we utilize our legal talents and resources. Well, the Bar Association chairman is here. Well, what role can the Bar Association play in this? With these opportunities, there will be more measures in the pipeline. May I ask Mr. Harris, how can the Bar Association notify its members or promote such professional opportunities? Mr. Paul Harris?
Here in front of this panel, the Bar Association very much supports these Greater Bay developments, and we do circulate our members when there's relevant information. For those who have the necessary language skills, those who are fluent in Putonghua, it is obviously a very good career opportunity, and the barristers, in my view, have much to offer by way of expertise and professional skills. So this is something of which we are very supportive.
So what role can the Bar Association play and how can they promote such opportunities? By what ways? Or how can you notify your members? Mr. Paul Harris?
I have just answered that. We have a system of circulars that go to every barrister, usually several issued every week. And when there's information, as there often is, relating to, for example, seminars about the Greater Bay Area, we circulate this information. So there is quite an extensive system in place to make sure that any barrister who wants to take advantage of these opportunities is notified of relevant opportunities through the bar.
好，唔該。好，跟住請周浩鼎議員。
Next, Mr. Holden Chow. And thank you, Chair. Just now, we heard that the press chairman of the Bar Association mentioned that he was very cooperative in helping the barristers to practice in the GBA. I hope that the GBA make good on the promise to help the barristers to practice in the GBA. Well, in the past, they appear to be not as cooperative. Well, for the EBRAM Online Dispute Resolution Center, well, just very quickly, I know that that the DOJ's did devoted some resources on EBRAM. Well, after it has been commissioned or opened, well, at the previous briefing, you mentioned about the caseload for EBRAM. I think that different members have heard about the briefing. Well, if I remember correctly, the EBRAM received less than 100 cases.
EBRAM Center invested quite an amount of resources, which was certainly good to see. So the point is how we can better promote its services. It engages in international arbitration and related services. But given the level of resources invested, should we better promote its services to Hong Kong people? Since we spend a lot of resources already, is there any way to more effectively promote the services of EBRAM Center to Hong Kongers so that they have a chance to use their services? I'd like to hear about this from the Secretary. On the EBRAM Center, consent from both parties needed in terms of dispute resolution. This is since the COVID-19 online dispute resolution platform was introduced, and I believe the response was very positive. in June. ERAM Center proposed a dispute resolution platform in Asia Pacific. Locally, the ERAM Center provides online training for arbitrators and mediators. For the DOJ, we would encourage them to provide more information for the general public. ERAM Center provides mediation services which could be more relevant for the general public, since most of them do not wish to enter into adversarial proceedings. I'm not mixing ADR and criminal services. No amount of work in ADR can deal with our backlog of cases. These include cases related to Occupy Central and the Black Lives violence in 2019. For Occupy Central, there are about 700 undisposed cases, more than 200 were disposed. What about the 700 odd cases? We have considered ONE, that is dropping often evidence for the cases from 2019. What about the outstanding 7,000 cases? Would you secure plea bargaining instead of making a decision 2 years later? You should be more proactive. I'm not mixing ADR with criminal prosecution. This is something I want to clarify. In terms of nurturing of talent, you said more would be done. We should promote cooperation locally. The DOJ should adopt a more proactive approach. They should be more proactive in securing the support of the Law Society and Bar Association, and the DOJ can pay the funds. I believe that is money well spent. That is the only way we can ensure a supply of talent. So the government should adopt a more proactive approach on this front. Do you need something in response from the secretary? No, but I don't mind if she has something to say. Thank you very much. Ms. Elizabeth Quad. Thank you. The administration indicated that a lot of laws have been amended, but the judiciary still fails to deal with the backlog of cases. They said they could deal with some 2,000 cases a year, and there are 8,000 outstanding cases for JRs, for non-refoulement claims. So hopefully the administration and judiciary can overcome this problem. Chairman, the judiciary has a new mechanism for handling complaints. I believe it's in force already. I wrote to the chairman before, hoping for an explanation from the judiciary on the entire complaints handling mechanism. Apparently, I have not received a reply, because that is of interest to many people. and in terms of sentencing guidelines for the anti-extradition law cases, would a sentencing commission be set up? The judiciary was yet to provide a response. And some people complain against magistrates or a particular magistrate. This is nothing personal. If a magistrate invariably hands down lenient sentences for all cases relating to the extradition law, so does it point to problems with the capability of that magistrate? Do you have a mechanism to deal with judges or magistrates who are often criticized for their judgments or sentences? Were magistrates allowed to hand down lenient sentences all the time due to a lack of sentencing guidelines from the judiciary? Thank you. For the new two-tier complaints mechanism against judges and judicial officers, it came into force in August, and at our meeting in August, we talked about controversial cases that attracted a lot of interest. When the committee met, members offered views on the system. The Chief Justice of the Court of Final Appeal, having considered the committee's views, we will make an announcement soon to highlight the discussion from our first meeting. For complaints related to controversial cases since the 16th of August, the advisory committee would provide recommendations to the Chief Justice. For other complaints, they would be discussed at the committee. In terms of sentencing, the judiciary already provided a response to the letter through AJLS panel. And in terms of a sentencing commission, recent discussions were mainly related to cases on the extradition law movement. The Court of Appeal deal with 18 cases. The judgments contain authoritative guidelines, and the guidelines would be followed by different levels of court, and the judiciary believes this is the proper approach to deal with the controversies. The Secretariat received a response and it was circulated with members already. I hope for an explanation in person at the panel. Any other questions? If not, the item would end here. Any other business? We have none. The meeting's adjourned. I'd like to thank the administration members and representatives from the bar.